Last month, we talked about Moses. We looked into the first six chapters of Exodus. And the theme is Moses, the person, his pursuit, and his passion. We learned there that Moses is a person is enveloped in his identity with God. Moses became who he is as a result of his relationship with the Lord. And another thing, Moses' pursuit is not his personal ambition, but rather it is God's plan and purpose for his life. And we also learn from our close look into the life of Moses, Moses' passion is for God and his people. How his heart begins to throb for God and for God's people. Were you part with us in learning together? What lesson, what important insight have you gained from our study of Moses? Ayan. Meron ba kayo naalalang isa? Well, if you could think of one, say it to your seatmate right now. This is what I've learned. I'll give you 1 minute to have a quick chat. This is what I learned from the life of Moses. Oh, it seems to be too quiet sa CCBC. Do you remember? You remember any lessons? Well, I encourage you, after the worship service, have lunch with whoever you would like to have lunch, and let it be what you're going to talk about. What have I learned from God's Word today? You know, as we look into this person, into the life of Moses, and think about ourselves having our own burning bush experience, and by the way, that's the aim of our series of studies. We'd like to emphasize to all of us that God is that we will have each of our own burning bush experience, our personal encounter with God. And in that encounter, there's always the temptation that it would seem our relationship with God is all about us. Today, we're going to zoom out of Moses, you know, and begin to see Moses in the context of where he was called. Moses was called because he is going to serve the nation Israel. God would like to form them as a nation, and he is going to put them in conflict with Pharaoh and with the nation Egypt. And it was placed in the context of what God is doing in our world today. Thus, in our studies of Exodus, in this series, I would like us to gain an understanding. What is God doing? What is the mission of God? And it is from the mission of God we will understand our mission as a church and our plan and purpose as a person. But it all starts with God. This is not about us. Moses' mission is enveloped and enfolded in God's plan for Israel. And whatever work God is doing is in Israel has something to do with his plan with the nations in the world. That's why in this series in October, I pray that we will gain an understanding of what the mission of God is all about. And I put it in three simple words. God is in the business of revealing himself. God is in the mission of redeeming people among the nations. And God is in the work of establishing his reign as king in this world. Thus, the title of the series is God and the Nations, Revelation redemption, and reign. We're going to take a look at the different events in the Exodus. The plagues, the Passover, and then the crossing of the Red Sea and his meeting in Mount Sinai. So the title of our series, God of All Nations. And on this Sunday, this particular hour, we're going to talk about the point of the plagues. And what's the point of the plagues? It's the revelation of God. Let's come to the Lord in prayer. Father, speak to us in a special way. Teach us, Lord, to have a heart that seeks for you, that we may know you in a special way. And this we ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. So instead of me reading to you Exodus chapter 7 to 11, and it will take me full 20 minutes to do that, Pastor Philip and I decided we'll just put it in a short video. We adapted a video from the internet and put it together for you. But giving you an introduction, while Exodus 1 to 6 focus was in Moses, the story zooms out from the man to the nation, as I've mentioned. Starting in Exodus 7, we are now brought into the scenario of the throne room of Pharaoh, the God of Egypt. And here, the saga begins. The God of Israel versus the God of Egypt. Let me present to you this video, a summary of the 10 plagues of Egypt.
Lord God, I did everything you told me, but I only made things worse.
Moses, go again to Pharaoh. I will make you like a god to him. Take your staff and stretch forth your hand upon the river. You shall multiply my wonders in the land, and in this shall they know that I am the Lord.
Pharaoh, the Lord God has commanded you to let his people go.
Ah, the Lord God of trickery again. Out of my way, Moses, or I'll trample you.
Behold his power!
And Moses did as the Lord commanded. He lifted up his staff in the sight of Pharaoh and struck the waters, and all the river turned to blood. Throughout all the land of Egypt, the waters turned to blood, and the fish died, and the rivers stank, and the Egyptians could not drink.
Another clumsy bit of magic? Fine. You've poisoned the water. I don't need to drink water when I have wine.
Your heart is hard, Pharaoh. But my God is stronger. The Lord God has instructed me. I will show you that he is the one true God. Pharaoh hears, but does not listen, Lord.
And frogs came up out of the river and spread over the land, and they died in the houses in heaps. And he hit the dust of the earth with his staff, and the dust became lice. Pharaoh's magicians could do nothing. There were lice upon man and beast. Then there came swarms of flies. The cattle died, and the land stank.
Flies are nothing, Moses.
Moses does bad tricks.
Exactly. Bad tricks and nothing more.
Then the people of Egypt were stricken with sores. Only the children of Israel were spared.
This is the finger of God.
We've called for Moses. He's here, right now.
Perhaps Pharaoh could get him to ask his God to Leave us alone.
I am God. Never forget that.
Yes, Pharaoh. We're sorry, Pharaoh.
These are worse than the lice and the flies.
They speak wisely, Pharaoh. All of this will cease only when you do as the Lord God commands. Let my people go. Release them from their bondage.
Leave this place or die.
But Pharaoh would not listen. So Moses stretched his hand towards heaven, and the Lord rained hail upon the land. Fire ran along the ground. Then locusts came to destroy the crops. Then a darkness came from God. For 3 days the earth was covered by darkness. There was only light in Goshen, and the green things slowly died.
Moses.
His God is destroying your kingdom. The crops die. The cattle die. Please send for him, O great Pharaoh.
Bring me Moses. Take this death from my kingdom!
How long will you wait before you see that this is all God's will? Don't hurt your people anymore. God commands you to let his people go. You've seen what the Lord God can do. The Lord God will bring one more plague upon Egypt. Tonight at midnight, the Lord will descend upon your kingdom. He will kill every firstborn son, from the rich to the poor in your dungeons. Only the children of Israel will be spared. Tomorrow you shall set them free as your great nation mourns and asks, why didn't Pharaoh heed the words of the Lord God?
You are banished from this house! Banished! If I ever see your face again, I'll kill you!
I will mourn your loss, Ramses. Goodbye, Pharaoh.
Father, I'm the firstborn. I'm afraid.
Don't be. This man is nothing. His God is nothing. His people are nothing.
Then why am I still scared?
What is the purpose of the plagues? What is the purpose of the story of the plagues? There are two reasons for that story. First, it's summed up in Exodus chapter 3, verse 20. And I read to you, so God said to Moses, I will stretch out my hand and strike the Egyptians with all the wonders I will perform among them. After that, he will let you go. So the purpose of this is to convince Pharaoh to release Israel from being slaves of Egypt so that they could do whatever God plans them to do, to redeem them. This is what I'm going to share with you next week, the picture of redemption. But you know what? There's a greater purpose why God would like to release Egypt. It is not only for the formation of Israel as a nation. It is not only to relieve them of their oppression. But God has a higher purpose, and it is expressed in Exodus 7, verse 5. And the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord when I stretch out my hand against Egypt and bring out the Israelites out of it. And what was the purpose? Beyond release of Israel, God's purpose that is that the Egyptians will know, that Pharaoh will know that I am the Lord. I would like us to take the note of the word know. Sa English, know could mean alam. Sa Tagalog, kaalaman. It is something that we put on our head. But in the language of the Bible, in the Hebrew, and even in the New Testament Greek, when you come across the word know, it talks more than just putting knowledge into your head. But it is more of something that, a knowledge that you experience in your life. It's like our word kilala. You know, there's a difference when you say, alam ko kung sino si Rodrigo Roa Duterte, to saying, kilala ko si Rodrigo Roa Duterte. It's something different. It is knowing that you have the knowledge and information in your head, and knowing in the sense that you are able to relate with a person as a result of that. When God said, and the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord, He was talking about experiential knowledge. They themselves will know the reality of who I am. You know what? I'd like to propose to you, brothers and sisters, this God is in the business of revealing Himself. And when we talk about revelations, it has something to do about God's mission. And the purpose why God wanted to present Himself, God wanted people to experience Himself. In Exodus 9:14, He says, that I might show you my power, and that my name will be what? Proclaimed where? Among the Israelites only? To the Egyptians only? No. In all the earth. So God has a missional purpose for the plagues, for whatever tragedy that is happening. In His sovereign plan, all of these things are happening for the purpose of His mission, that He will be known and He will be revealed in the world. You know what? Just to backtrack, just to put us in context of Egypt, in context of Exodus, it has been 400 years since the Israelites heard from God. The last word was from Joseph. And then after that, the generations after that, all they heard was second-hand and third-hand accounts of who that God is. Imagine yourself in a setting, you know, the last time you have heard about God speaking was many generations ago, 400 years ago. What do you think happens in the spirituality of Israel? You know what? Try to do this. Don't read your Bible. Don't listen to God. Don't pray for 1 week, for 1 month. You know what happens to you? You will feel like a person with merely a religion. The point of the revelation, why God wants to reveal Himself, is that He wanted to have a relationship with the people to whom He reveals with. So what is revelation? Let me define it for you. It's quite a technical term. It simply means God disclosing Himself. But it is more than just disclosing Himself. It is the act of God making Himself known to the world. Yes, if you look at the stars, you look at creation, we could easily come to the conclusion that there is a God who created everything. But we will end with just that. It is important that this Creator God disclose Himself to us so that we will know what is in His heart, what is His plan, His purpose. and what He desires for you. Mga kapatid, ang Diyos po ay Diyos na nangungusap sa atin. The book of Proverbs says, where there is no revelation, people perish. It is important for us that we know who God is. Now, what do the plagues? The story from Exodus 7 to 11 tell us about the Lord. There are three, I put it in three summary points. Number one, the plagues tell us that God is mighty. Let me put it to you in context. You know, back then, the people knew that the name, that Yahweh is Israel's God. But in the minds of the Egyptians, since the Israelites are slaves of the Egyptians, therefore, Yahweh is a slave God. Since the Israelites are our slaves, their God is also the God, the slave of our God. You know, they have a low view of that God. God allowed these plagues to happen so that the Egyptians and the world will know that He is mighty. He is not just a slave God. The fact is, it is easy for God to just let and work it out. If the goal is just to release Israel from slavery, it is easy for God to work out His power and the Israelites could immediately be released. But God allowed this power to encounter to happen. You know why? He does not want the Israelites to leaving a reputation that there's a God with the Israelite, but He is just a slave God like them. And they will be wandering around the wilderness, and people will just conclude that He is a nomadic God like them, uncivilized. But you know what? In God's mighty acts, there was a purpose for that. That the Lord will be known not only in Egypt, but His might will be known among the nations. And then the second point that I'd like to emphasize here is that the Lord brings judgment. And then another thing that the Lord revealed in this incident is that He cares. He cares for His people. Let me unpack these points. The might of the Lord. First, He pointed out that God, Yahweh, is mightier than the forces of creation. Look at the plagues. What are the plagues all about? These are God's work in the created order. He turned the river Nile into blood. He brought frogs, multitudes and multitudes of frogs in the city. He turned the dust into lies, into gnats, nik-nik ang tawag natin. And then suddenly there were so much flies around. And then He caused the death of the cattle. He caused boils, rain, hail, big chunks of ice raining down from the heavens. There was locusts. There was 3 days of darkness. And there was death of the firstborn. All of these are natural occurrences. And God is demonstrating to us He is God over nature. He is God over creation. And the ultimate thing for the Israelites was then when they witnessed God opening up the Red Sea. And it was there, it became clear in their minds that their God is not an ordinary God. He is the one who created everything that they see in this world. And more than that, it is taught in this story that God is mightier than the magicians. By the way, when you read this, nabasa niyo sa Bible that Moses encountered magicians, He is not talking about illusionists. Today, magicians will never tell themselves that we are magicians. They know that they are merely illusionists. They have this quick sway of the hands. Ayan. Because magicians have something to do with knowledge of the things of the spirits. They are connected with the spirits. And the Lord demonstrates that He is mightier than the power of the magicians. Let me quickly show you and run to you the different statements that were made about these magicians. When When Moses and Aaron stood up before Pharaoh, and Aaron threw his staff and it became a snake, this is what Pharaoh did, and he was expecting that kind of encounter. He said he summoned among the intelligent people in his court, he summoned the Egyptian magicians and also did the same things by their secret arts. What did they do? Each one threw down his staff and it became a snake. But Aaron's staff swallowed up their staffs. The point is, Pharaoh wanted to be prepared to make a mockery of the God of Israel. So when the first plague happened, that is turning the river into blood, verse 22 of Exodus 7, it says there, but the Egyptian magicians did the same thing by their secret arts. They turned water into blood. Kaya namin ito. We can do that. So, what's the point of following your God? And as a result, Pharaoh's heart continue to harden. And the same thing in Exodus chapter 8, verse 7, when there was the plague of the frogs, it says there, the magician did the same things by their secret arts. They were able to produce many frogs. So, as a result of the plague, many frogs came and it became a nuisance, kaguluhan doon sa Egypt. And what the Egyptians did, kasi gusto nila magbida kay Pharaoh, they multiplied the frogs even more. And you will see here a subtle movement of the sovereignty of God. Okay, you want to make a mockery of me? You want to duplicate what I do? Tingnan ninyo, mas malaki ang problema. Alam po ninyo, in our world today, many people would like to make a mockery of God by saying, with all the scientific advancement, with all the medical technology that we have, I do not believe in miracles anymore, therefore I do not believe in God. You know, people would say, oh, there is so much advancement in our thinking today and in science, that because of that, therefore it's okay to be skeptical about the existence of God. It's something like this. They are saying, you know, since I can duplicate what God has been doing in the past and it is regarded as miracle, it's not a miracle anymore, and therefore we don't have a need for God. Or we could come to a conclusion, I don't need God. Let me ask you, brother, sister, friend, are you in that kind of mindset of skepticism? Let's follow through these magicians. In somewhere in Exodus chapter 8, verse 18, in the plague of the gnats, it says there, when the plague happened, the magicians tried to produce gnats by their secret arts, and it says there, they could not. In other words, they can duplicate what God is doing up to a certain extent only, and this is still plague number 4, and there are still 6 plagues to go. You know, there is only a point that you can duplicate what God is doing. But after that point, you know, it's way, way, way beyond you. One of the things that I appreciate today with today's doctors, like in the testimony of our brother Jun Perez and his son, who is also a cardiologist, highly trained, highly specialized. They know how the heart works intimately. They know how to do, how to cure it and all of those things. But in their testimonies, you know, the team of doctors says, when Brother June's heart had a big hole, gaping hole, and blood was really pouring out of it, to them, that's the end of what they could do. They just did their best to plug the hole, but they do not know if Brother June is going to survive it. And in a video testimony, these doctors were saying that was the hand of God moving. We may have the best education, we may be the best in what we are doing, but there's only a limit in what we could achieve. And there is the hand of God moving. So these magicians came to that point. They could say, well, this is the limit of what we could do. And more so, in verse 19, they say, They reported to Pharaoh, "Pharaoh, you know what? That is the finger of God moving and we cannot duplicate it." Kung tatagalugin ko ito, mga kapatid, ang sinasabi ng mga magicians, kalingkingan pa lang yan ng Diyos. Hindi na natin kayang tapatan. In other words, the magicians, the experts, the knowledgeable in the court of Pharaoh were saying, we have a lot of this power, we have a lot of this knowledge. But that is just the finger of God. There's still more to come. I think many of them came to that point of acknowledging who God is and His might. And then another thing about these gods. You know, these magicians really, in their minds at that time, they think that the forces of nature are controlled by gods, small gods. And then magicians or mediums, they say if you could control and influence this god, then you could influence that power. So the plagues demonstrate, and many students of the Bible came to that conclusion that the plagues is meant to make a mockery of the gods of Egypt. For example, in the first plague, when he turned the river Nile into blood, God is making a mockery into one of the most powerful gods of Egypt, and that is the god Osiris, who is the god of the river, one who gives life to them. And God turned it into blood. And Egypt has so many gods. And God is demonstrating He is above all that. You know, that kind of mindset, it still exists today. Just yesterday, I was in our outreach in Morong. I visited one of our contacts there. A few weeks ago, I saw her. She has had problems with her hands. It was infected with allergy and other infections. You know, napaka-doctor, nurse ako. Anyway, I gave her something to work on. I saw her again, and it has improved a lot. Pero sabi niya, Pastor, Makati pa rin. You know what my neighbors are telling me, Pastor? What are they telling you? Because I was working on my garden, natamaan ko raw yung tinitiran ng duwende. Actually, I wanted to react that way. Tatawa ako. Pero it came to me, no, this is reality to them. Not for me, from Metro Manila. It may be true. And I know about the God who is above all the powers and above all the powers of that demigod trying to overthrow the power of this human being. So instead of telling her, don't believe that, I told her, come, let's see and witness how our God is over all those spirits in your garden. This is what was happening. When God was demonstrating His might in the people of Egypt and demonstrating His power over all gods, God is also saying that He is mightier than the most powerful god of Egypt, and that is Pharaoh himself. We're going to do that, to show that to you eventually next week. But now I would like us to do fast forward 2,000 years later from the story of Exodus. Jesus, when He came here on earth, we find Him walking with His disciples. They were taking a boat in the middle of a lake, and suddenly a squall, a storm happened. Jesus arose and He spoke to the wind. He spoke to the sea, and it calmed. And then after that, this is how Mark described the incident. The disciples were terrified and they asked each other, who is this? Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey Him. You know, it's a rhetorical question they were asking. This is our teacher. He's more than a teacher. You know, the winds and the waves obey Him. Only one person can do that. And that is God. This teacher of ours must be the Creator God. You know, in essence, Jesus is revealing who the Creator is to His disciples and to the people around Him at that time, that He is mightier than the forces of creation. He is mightier than the gods of this world. He is mightier than the people who wield power in this world. And another thing about that God, inasmuch that He is mighty, He is also a God who brings judgment. If you look into the story of the plagues, it tells us that in every episode of the plague, it starts with a word of warning from God. Let me give you an example. In Exodus 8, verse 2, I think this is the plague of the frogs. The first statement there that came from God to Pharaoh was this: if you refuse to let my people go, then I will send a plague. There's a word of warning. And that word of warning, in due time, God is going to execute the judgment. This is what the Lord says. This is the last plague, the death of the first person. About midnight, so there's a time, I will go throughout Egypt. Every firstborn son in Egypt will die. Why is God doing that? He is doing that as a consequence of Pharaoh's rejection of God's word for his life. Since Pharaoh would harden his heart, he would refuse to listen to God, he will turn his back to God. God is saying, you deserve, therefore, the consequence, my judgment, and He Himself is going to execute it. You know what? God has already demonstrated His power, and He is saying, I am the holy God, and I am going to mete out justice, judgment, to those who refuse to submit me and to submit to my will. And He made it happen. Fast forward 2,000 years later, and we look at the Son of God, Jesus Christ, while He was here on earth. While He was walking through the hills of Gerasene, He met a man who was possessed by a legion of demons. And this was how Mark described the scene. When he saw this demon-possessed man, Jesus, from a distance, he ran, and what did he do? He fell on his knees in front of him. Those demons cannot help but recognize God, the Son of God, who is Jesus Christ. They worshiped him. And then he shouted at the top of his voice, "What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? In God's name, don't torture me." What was the attitude of the demons? They were trembling in fear because in front of them is the God who is going to judge them because of their evil ways. Alam nyo, when I read this, I would always come to the conclusion, mabuti pa ang demonyo nanginginig sa takot. Ang tao kaya. Brothers, sisters in the Lord, do these facts still strike fear in your heart that the God we serve is the God who judges? The God who gives a stern warning, the God who declares His word, this is what is going to happen to you unless you turn your heart to me. You know what? In the story of the plagues, we see instead of Pharaoh's heart softening, all the more it hardens. It hardens. I remember a story of my wife's father, Hernan Hobson. Earlier when I wedded into the family, there was a time that, you know, it's a family gathering and we prayed together thanking God for the food and for everything that He has blessed us with. And we were shocked when after that he made a statement. He said, "What? To whom are you giving thanks over this? Didn't I work? Aren't these the fruits of my labor? Isn't this beautiful table the fruits of my work? Isn't this nice house, everything you see? Didn't we work hard for it? Why are we thanking God for that? You know, I know the brothers and sisters have been trying to convince him, trying to tell him to turn his heart to Jesus. But back then, we could see and sense how he would further harden his heart. And I'm not surprised, because this is a self-made man, one who lived in abject poverty, growing up as a boy in Negros, took a boat as a stowaway, hindi nagbayad ng pamasahe, trying to hide in the boat, lived as a street kid, faced the hardship of life, but became a big businessman later on in his life, a highly respected businessman. And he was saying, why are we thanking God? That is the kind of heart that Pharaoh has. Let me ask you, brothers and sisters in the Lord, friend, what kind of heart do you have for the Lord? Let me go back to the story. In the plagues, Exodus 7 to 10, we will also see that the Lord who reveals himself, he revealed that he is God who cares, a God who is merciful, a God who is gracious. He is concerned with his people. Exodus 3:7, in his dialogue with Moses, he said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. I am concerned. You see the heart of God there? And you will see how he acted on what he has in his heart. He protected his people. For example, in one of the plagues, I think this is the plagues of the flies. It says there, but on that day I will deal differently with the land of Goshen where my people live. No swarms of flies will be there, so that you will know that I, the Lord, am in this land. And I will make, you see, I will make a distinction between my people and your people. So the one who belongs to him, he is going to protect them. He cares for them, and he protects even those who fear him. Look at these verses. These talks about the officials of Pharaoh, the Egyptians. You know, there are portion of the Egyptian population who begin to believe in God, who begin to fear the Lord. It says there, these officials of Pharaoh who feared the word of the Lord hurried to bring their slaves and their livestock inside. But those who ignored the word of the Lord left their slaves and livestock in the field. There are only two kinds of people when it comes to the Lord, word of the Lord, when God reveals himself. It is either you receive him, you fear him as God, or you reject him. Today, Egyptians, we see them in their hearts, to some of them, they are beginning to respect, to fear, and to revere the Lord. When the Lord spoke, they said, oh, this is going to happen. Let us prepare ourselves. Do we have that kind of attitude? The Lord cares. Fast forward, Jesus Christ. He was introduced by John the Baptist as the judge of God, the one who is going to bring judgment. And he said, by whose account kings will rise and fall, and that is Jesus Christ. When the disciples met Jesus, they saw a different person. In fact, these words came from him, come unto me, all ye who labor and are so burdened because of the effect of sin in your life. You're so tired. You know you deserve judgment. But I want to give you rest. Come. Come. Respond to me. How are you responding to God? When God speaks, when God presents Himself to you, when God is making Himself known to you through the tragedies, through the challenges, through the circumstances you're facing day to day. You know, the point of the experience of the plagues is what? God wants the people to know who He is. He is inviting them for a relationship. Let me go back to Exodus 9:14. It says there, that I might show you my power and that my name will be proclaimed in all the earth. Now, what do we draw? What would this mean for us, for each one of us? First, God speaks. Do we listen? When I was young here at CCBC, my disciples, you know, when we, they talk about God's will a lot. God's will, God's will. And I'm puzzled. How do we know God's will? How do we know that He's doing? Oh, George, simply, you know, you do it by prayer. The Holy Spirit is there. You do it by spending time with the Word. I do that. But how do you hear from God? And then somebody explained to me, oh, you know, George, you know, when you read from His Word, sometimes God will speak to you like a whisper. You have to hear that and respond to it. And if you don't listen, He will speak to you like somebody calling your attention. Tinatapik ka sa likod. You know? But still, if you don't listen, babatukan ka ng Diyos. Sounds funny, but you know what? It's a reality. What is God doing in your life today? Nandun pa ba siya sa whisper? O nandun na siya sa pagbatok sa'yo? Shaking you up. Makinig ka na. I'm giving you a warning. And that is what God did to Egypt, to Pharaoh. Another thing, God's revelation, when He reveals Himself, the purpose of that is not to add information into your minds. No. When God speaks, when God reveals, He is waiting for a response. And there are only two responses, general responses that you could do. It's either you receive Him or you reject Him. It's either you say yes to Him or you say no to Him. Where in your heart are you? Let me end the story of my father-in-law. I don't want you to give a negative picture about that. You know, in his later years, after so many prayers from his children that his heart would soften eventually, it would not be like Pharaoh whose heart is hardened. There came a time when, you know, Henry C. opened up his big mall over there. They were kind of contemporaries. And him and the others who are in that same kind of business, retail business, department store business, they were kind of intimidated. Initially, they were saying, is he crazy? And then later on, when it's growing, oh, what's happening? There is going to kill us in the industry. And then when there was a strike in his company, he took the opportunity. I'm done with it. After running this business for more than 30 years, I'm going to sell it. And what he did is he divested of himself of that, took the money, and spent almost the whole of it out on his farm in Mindoro. Suddenly, high-tech yung farm. There's so many activities, so many things going on there. It was very hopeful, you know. It has a lot of potential to earn a lot of things. And then one day, a big storm, a big typhoon visited the Philippines. It went directly into the island of Mindoro. In a matter of few days, many of his investments wiped out. We were wondering, how would my father-in-law respond and react? And later on in one of the family meetings, he made a deep confession to us. After seeing what happened, after thinking about what has happened in my life, I came to realize that God is real. He is the one in control. And I must surrender everything to Him. Ever since that time, you know, when grandchildren and children goes around him, he would, as old men would always do, they will tell stories of their childhood, what has happened in the past, how he had to leave Negros because, you know, his father's carabaos died, and how he stayed in the boat as a stowaway, how he has lived as a street kid in Manila, and how he has worked on a horse barn for an army, and how he was drafted into the army, how he was abandoned by his commanding officer, how the ROTC of Ateneo recruited him and his horses, and how he became part of that force that defended Bataan, how they fought there for many weeks without food, how they were forced to march from Bataan down to UST. He would always tell about the faithfulness. I didn't realize God was there. God was there protecting me. Even though I was hungry, I didn't feel sick. Even though I was marching all through this distance, I didn't fall in sickness. Many of us are dying like flies. Even when we were incarcerated in UST, nakulong sila sa UST. And my fellow soldiers, because of the psychological torture, they would climb up the walls and then they will fall down in a suicide, heads first, just to end their suffering. You know, it didn't come to his mind to do that to himself and just hang on until he was released by the Japanese forces. And then he talks about the bombing of Manila, how the bombs fell and the Lord protected them, how God caused them to pick up the pieces, started by being a small vendor out in a market in Sampaloc to become a big grocery owner, to become a big department store owner, and how the Lord has blessed him. And he saw, and he would always conclude to his children and to his grandchildren, that God has always been relentless in being faithful to him. You know, that's the story of the plagues. It speaks about the relentlessness of the mercy of God. At the beginning of the story, God already gave Moses the hint. You know, I'm going to kill his firstborn, and his heart is going to change. He's going to release you. You know, the story could easily end that way. Why do Moses have to go through that difficulty of facing Pharaoh all the time? He could just go to the end part of the story, kill the firstborn, and then you will be released. There's a purpose for that. God was merciful. He was calling and calling Pharaoh and the Egyptians to fear him, to acknowledge that he is God. He is gone until that ultimate time. You know, perhaps God is dealing with you in that manner, nudging you, whispering to you, giving you a hard time, giving you challenges in life, because He is calling and calling upon you. Come, come. Know me as your God. Know me as your Savior. Are you willing to receive Him? Or are you going to continue to reject Him? And finally, what other lessons we could learn? If God's mission is to make Himself known to all nations, what are we doing to see that happen? You have a part, each of us have a part in doing what God is doing, revealing Himself to the nations. That's why CCBC, we have this slogan, strategically engaged in nations discipleship. We are all part of God's mission. At CCBC, it's our practice. You know, we have money that we send to support missionaries, our missions, faith promise. What is it that we support? There are so many things to support out there. One of the first things we support are those missionaries and mission agencies engaged in proclaiming who God is. Like the work of translating scriptures into the languages of the people that they reach out to, like the Galor ports. For decades now, they have been translating the Bible into the Northern Subanen language. We support them. We want to see that the Bible will come into the hands and that they would read it in their own language. Our deaf community here, the leaders of our deaf community, particularly Pastor Julius Andrada, he is part of the Summer Institute of Linguistics, the Wycliffe, the Wycliffe family. And he was recruited and appointed to do Bible translation to the Filipino Sign Language. He is one of the key players in that team. A CCBCer, mga kapatid. Yes, praise God. There's Pastor Julius. Actually, I'm saying this because you need to pray for her. That's not an easy task. You know, many of the deaf community, they are having a difficult time reading our Bible, the printed one. So they have to work on it in the Filipino Sign Language. And one of the things we'd like to do with Pastor Julius, one of the plans, whenever he preaches, it will be videoed. Because our deaf community, they love preaching from a deaf person rather, you know, a translated preacher who just speaks and they cannot hear, like the one standing before you now. And he's a good Bible teacher for the deaf, speaking and talking to it by the language. We support that kind of ministry. We're also in Bible engagement ministry, ministries that promote hunger and thirst for scriptures, like what the Estebans are doing out there in Aklan, like what the Dalimbangs are doing. We are in the ministry, we support ministries that engages in proclaiming the gospel, telling people about Jesus, in teaching the word of God. We are in church planting and many, many other more. You know, we as a church align with God by supporting and being part of these mission endeavors that declares who God is to others. So the question for us, if God's mission is to make himself known to all the nation, what are we supposed to be doing to see that happen?